Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Outpost, a post-apocalyptic survival thriller by Kellee L. Greene. Narrated by Patricia Santomasso. Chapter 1. The feel of the cold, icy metal in my hand made me shiver. Holding a gun wasn't something I was comfortable with, but with how things were going, that was going to need to change. Dax shouldn't have left his pistol sitting on the table unattended, but then again, I shouldn't have been standing out in the open by myself, aiming the gun at my contagious, already dead, and horribly diseased husband. If the sick weren't totally eliminated by fire, decapitation, or cutting out their hearts, they'd just keep popping back up over and over again, trying to spread the virus. It was like the virus had complete control over their bodies and minds. With my daughter Maddie across the street, I had to do something about Freddie. Even though their relationship had been rocky, I couldn't allow her to see her contagious father pacing back and forth in front of what used to be our home. It was like he was waiting for us. I aimed the gun at Freddie. It was going to take more than a bullet to get rid of him, but I had a plan. The pop of the gun vibrated through my arms and shook my body. It wasn't so much the power of the gun that rattled me. It had more to do with the fact that I'd never fired a gun before. It was loud. It was scary. It was powerful. I hated to admit it, even to myself, but it kind of felt good after everything Freddie had put me through to put a bullet between his eyes. My accuracy was frighteningly good. Of course, there was no way I could have ever done that to him had he been alive, but since he was a disease-carrying monster, it was a bit easier to do what needed to be done. "I'm tempted to drag you into the basement and lock you up in there," I said to his unmoving body. He should suffer like I had living with him. I put on the kitchen gloves I'd found in one of Blake's drawers in his kitchen and grabbed Freddie's legs. He was significantly heavier than I thought he'd be. There'd been one time in my life, many years ago, when I'd hit Freddie back. It had been like throwing my fist into a brick wall. Freddie wasn't a big man. He was average, but apparently very, very solid. I shook my head as I remembered the sick, stupid smile that had been on his face and the evil laugh that had erupted at my attempt to fight back. It was one of the few times I fought back. "You were a terrible husband and a dreadful father," I said as I dragged him toward the gate of our fenced-in backyard. "I hope you rot in hell." I dragged Freddie through the backyard and far away from the house. My hand shook as I pulled a lighter out of my pocket and dragged my finger over the grooves of the lighter. The flame flicked upward and wavered slightly in the breeze I couldn't feel. I kneeled down next to Freddie and set the flame to the ragged edges of the bottom of his jeans. It took longer than I had expected for the fire to catch onto the fabric. I took several steps back and swallowed. There was a brief hesitation when I considered putting out the fire. I had to remind myself that it wasn't really Freddie lying in the yard. It might look like him, but it was something else. Something sick. Something deadly. One less of those with the sickness was helping us. Protecting Maddie. It took longer than I thought it would before Freddie's entire body was engulfed in flames. He didn't open his eyes. He didn't move. And thankfully, he didn't scream out in pain or beg for help. "Jesus, kid!" A small breath got stuck in my throat at the sound of the voice behind me. I turned with the gun still in my hand. "What the hell do you think you're doing?" Blake said with a fire extinguisher in his hand. "No," I said, holding up my hand. "It's Freddie. I had to do it. He was just pacing in front of the house." Blake shook his head.
"I heard the gunshot and I was more than halfway here when I saw the smoke," Blake said, pointing up toward the sky. "The other people in town will see it too."
"I couldn't risk Maddie seeing him like that," I said.
"Why didn't you tell me? I could have helped you," Blake said. I looked at the gun in my hand. I stared at it for several minutes. This just felt like it was my problem to deal with. Freddy has been a problem of mine for quite some time. It was time. I let my shoulders relax.
Nothing is just your problem anymore. We're in this together, Blake said. But it's not going to work if we keep secrets from each other.
I'm sorry, I said, handing Blake the gun.
Don't apologize, Blake said, raising a brow. You can talk to me.
He looked at the gun and sighed before tucking it into the back of his waistband. Blake's eyes flicked upward and locked with mine.
I'll take you back to the house, Blake said. Let me finish up here.
Didn't you just say we're in this together? I asked, cocking my head to the side. I'm not leaving here until I know he's not going to spring back up and start pacing in front of the house again. Blake jerked his chin toward the flaming mass on the ground.
It won't be much longer.
Freddy was melting away. The skin on his face was dripping off his bones. His torso, arms, and legs looked like an odd-shaped balloon with a small leak. He was deflating. I didn't feel relieved. The damage Freddy had done to me was long since over, but it was deep, permanent. The hiss from the extinguisher startled me. My eyes nearly popped out of my head as I turned to look at Blake. Why? I blurted.
He's gone, Blake said. There's nothing left. He won't be back.
Are you sure? I asked. How can we know that? Blake shrugged.
I guess there is no way to know for sure, but I think he's gone for good.
I crossed my arms and nodded. Okay.
Are you?
Blake asked, narrowing his eyes at me.
Yeah,
I said. I think so. It's hard to believe this isn't all a bad dream, and I'm going to wake up back in my normal nightmare.
This is not a dream, Blake said. If it were, Dax wouldn't have left his gun where you'd take it, and you wouldn't have left the house without telling me.
My lips curled at the ends. That would only be true if it were your dream. This seems more like one of mine.
Come on, Blake said, jerking his head toward the gate. Let's get back home.
I frowned. This is my home.
Well, please come back to my house with me, Blake said. It's probably not good for us to be hanging around out here, and not just because of sickness that could be floating through the air.
You're worried about the other survivors? I asked. It wasn't that I wasn't also worried. I wanted to know why he was concerned.
Yes, Blake said. They aren't being smart. Not to mention that when their supplies start to dwindle, they'll start searching for more. They'll get desperate.
I chewed my cheek. If you don't think we're safe at your place.
I think we're safe, Blake answered quickly. For now.
He looked up at the storm clouds moving in.
Out here, though, is a different story. Let's go back inside.
I nodded and walked toward the front yard. Blake was close behind. The gate squeaked as I pushed it open. Blake grabbed my hand and pulled me back behind the fence.
Did you hear that?
Blake asked. Hear what?
Shh,
he said, tapping his finger to his lips aggressively. I listened, but I didn't hear anything except the extremely distant rumble of thunder. Or what I was hearing wasn't thunder at all. The sound grew louder. It was an engine coming from what sounded like a rather large vehicle. Blake placed his hand on my shoulder.
Stay down.
Chapter 2. Blake and I were crouched down low to the ground. We kept ourselves hidden behind the fence, out of sight. I leaned forward, pressing my face to the rough wood peeking out between the boards, watching to see if the vehicles would come down the road. I couldn't see anything. The clouds moved quickly across the sky, blocking out the sun. There was still enough light to see our surroundings, but the shadows that were created chilled me down to the bone. The vehicle was close, but it seemed as though it had stopped somewhere down the road. It wasn't getting louder, nor was it getting quieter.
It felt like the truck was vibrating the earth under my feet. Blake turned slowly and looked at me. Then his neck twisted a bit more as he glanced at the yard behind us. It was like he was checking to make sure the remnants of Freddy were still where we'd left them, and that he hadn't risen.
"Should we go inside?" I whispered.
Blake pulled in a long breath. His eyes moved along the ground, stopping at the back door. It seemed as though he was mentally counting the steps it would take to get us inside. He nodded and gestured for me to lead the way. Blake followed me closely. I glanced back at him frequently to make sure he was still there. I was afraid of losing him, even in the 15 steps to the back door. He was holding the gun, and his eyes darted around, even though he couldn't see anything beyond the fence. Blake didn't know how often I checked for him over my shoulder, because he was too busy checking over his own. I dug in my pocket and pulled out my set of keys. My fingers shook as I fumbled around, looking for the correct one. It took only a few seconds, but it felt like hours had gone by. I slowly opened the door, jerking slightly at the squeak it always made at the halfway point. I winced at the sharp sound and stepped inside the house. Blake slipped in behind me and closed the door in one silent but swift movement. He turned the lock and exhaled.
"Stay away from the windows, in case they're out there wandering around."
"Who? The sick or someone else?" I asked with a nod.
"Maybe both," Blake answered.
"What do you think they're doing out there?" I asked. Blake stared at the window from several feet away.
"No idea."
A gunshot split the air. Blake grabbed me and tackled me to the floor. We landed hard. His body was mostly on top of mine, protectively. The sound was close, perhaps just a few houses away.
"No!"
The voice sliced through the air, but it was instantly followed by another shot. Moments later, the engine roared. It wasn't long until we couldn't hear anything, except for the rain violently pounding the roof. Blake didn't move, but I suddenly became very aware of how close he was to me.
"What the hell was that?" I asked, finding my voice. "No idea," Blake said, clearing his throat as he gently rolled off me. "Maybe they found some of the sick and needed to put them out of their misery."
"Yeah, maybe," I said, wrapping my arms around myself as I sat up on the floor. The house was close, and with the rain, it felt as though the temperature was dropping rapidly. Blake stood and offered me his hand.
"Need anything while we're here? Otherwise, we should probably get back."
I took his hand and he pulled me to my feet. We stood there, staring at one another from only inches apart. The rain sounded louder in the silence between us. I took a step back and exhaled. "There's probably tons I could use, but I can't think of a single thing," I said. It was odd, standing in the familiar surroundings. I wasn't sure why, but it no longer felt like my home. It was all of my things, but somehow it all felt different. Blake's house didn't feel more like a home to me either. It definitely was his space, and most of the time, I felt like I was a guest. It was more like I didn't have a home anymore. There was no place where I could relax and feel comfortable. That just didn't exist for me anymore. And maybe it never would.
"We're going to get soaked out there," Blake said as he carefully pulled back the curtain an inch. "Do you have an umbrella?"
"Yeah," I said, walking over to the front closet with my arms still wrapped around my shivering body. I reached inside and pulled out the old umbrella that opened crooked and had a small tear in the plastic. It would still get the job done, and that was really all that mattered.
"Maybe grab a coat, too," Blake suggested.
I reached my shaking hand inside and pulled out one of my old hoodies. Blake took it from me and held it open for me, as if we were on our way to a fancy restaurant on a date.
"Are you sure you're okay?" Blake asked.
"Yeah, I'm fine. I mean, I'm okay as I possibly can be after shooting and burning my already dead husband," I said. The gunshots down the road really didn't help matters, but yeah, I'm okay. Doing better than I would have imagined, anyway. I slipped my arms into my jacket. Blake kept his hands on my shoulders for a long moment before going back to the window. I sighed loudly as I looked toward the kitchen. Every single cabinet was open, and one of the chairs at the dining room table had been knocked over. My eyes darted around, noticing other small things that seemed different from the last time I'd been inside the house. The glass Freddy had been using was on its side on the end table. The refrigerator door was wide open. Even the door leading to the basement was open. I wonder if Freddy had come inside at some point, I said, with my eyes still narrowed. Or did you and Dax leave it like this when we came over here for the food and supplies?
What do you mean?
Blake asked, looking around. It seemed to take him a bit longer to notice the differences.
No,
he said, shaking his head. His eyes were wide and suddenly filled with panic. He raised the gun and stood in front of me.
We didn't leave things like that.
If the sick can just walk inside a house, then we're all in big trouble, aren't we? I asked. Blake swallowed hard.
I don't think the sick can get inside without being let in. And even if they could get inside, why would they open cabinets and doors as if looking for something?
Freddy was probably looking for booze, I said with a nervous chuckle. Blake turned to me as if he were checking to see if I was serious. I shook my head and looked away from him.
He would have known where it was, Blake said matter-of-factly, unless you hid it from him.
I didn't. Would he remember, though? Do the sick remember things? I asked, even though my mind went right to when I first saw Freddy pacing in front of the house.
They must know to some extent. Otherwise, why would Freddy have lingered here? He could have been out there, looting liquor stores and spreading the sickness at the same time.
Blake's shoulders dropped, and he ran his fingers through his hair.
I have no idea about any of this, but we need to get out of here.
I squeezed myself tighter. My voice was softer than a whisper. You don't think they're still here, do you?
No, probably not. But that doesn't mean they won't come back, Blake said.
How did they even get inside? I asked. The doors were locked. Blake pointed at the front door.
Well, it's not locked now.
Oh my God, I said, slapping my hand over my mouth.
What is it?
Blake asked with concern. I broke the basement window. That's how they got in, I said. Freddy locked me down there the night everything happened. I broke the window. It's my fault someone came in here. Blake stared at me.
He locked you in the basement?
Oh, I said, feeling the heat rising to my cheeks. I was embarrassed. It was the first time I'd ever told anyone what kinds of things Freddy had done to me. I'd never even given the details to Polly or my mom. Sure, they knew things were bad, but they didn't know exactly how bad.
Did he do that a lot?
Blake asked softly. Oh, no, I said, as if that somehow would make it better. Only a handful of times when he was extremely intoxicated. My throat dried. Why was I making excuses for dead Freddy?
Jesus, kid. I'm so sorry,
Blake said as he looked down at his feet. His eyes flicked up.
If I would have known, I would have done something.
You couldn't have known, I said, wishing I wouldn't have let it slip that Freddy had locked me in the basement. It probably changed how Blake saw me. Let's get out of here. Blake nodded as he reached out for my hand. He pulled me to the window and didn't let go while he looked in every possible direction.
I don't know how safe we really are in this town, Blake said.
I don't know either, I said.
We might not be able to stay here,
Blake said. My mouth dropped open. What other choice is there?
I'm not sure, Blake said. I shouldn't have mentioned it. You have enough on your mind.
He led me to the door and squeezed my hand before he opened it. The umbrella, I said, reaching for where it was propped up against the wall. Blake tugged me back.
Forget it. We're going to run.
Chapter 3.
I still had my hoodie on when we sat down for dinner. The chill wouldn't leave my bones, even in Blake's warm home. My hair hadn't completely dried from running across the street during the downpour. I was sure I looked like hell. Maddie kept looking up at me while we ate. I knew she was wondering why my hair was wet, but she probably thought it had something to do with our plan to leave. Maddie and I were going to leave to find Polly. Whitney knew, although she didn't know when we were going to leave. There was no way in hell that Whitney was going to tell either Blake or Dax about our plan. She was anxious for us to leave so she could have her space back. "This is really good, Dax," Whitney said with a big grin on her face.
"Thank you," Dax said. "Our meals are going to change soon, though."
"What do you mean?" Whitney asked. Dax glanced over at Blake. It was as though there was something they'd both been keeping from us since we'd returned with Maddie.
"It's not a big deal," Blake said, holding up his hand. "We'll figure it out."
"Figure what out?" Whitney asked, crossing her arms. Blake groaned as he leaned back in his chair.
"We're running a bit low on gas for the generator."
"Oh my God," Whitney gasped as she brought her fingers to her mouth. "We won't have heat or electricity? How will we survive?" Blake rolled his eyes.
"People can survive without those things."
"We'll freeze when winter comes," Whitney said.
"Calm down," Blake said, and Dax chuckled. "We'll be able to get more gas."
"How?" Whitney stood and glared at them. Blake rolled his eyes.
"We'll get it from a gas station, or siphon it from cars in the neighborhood. Dax shouldn't have said anything."
"It's a terrible idea to go out there to get gas," Whitney said. The look in her eyes was changing to worry. "The sick are out there, and those people with guns. No way I'm letting either of you go out there again."
Blake looked at me. Whitney still wasn't happy about going out to get Maddie. "It'll be fine," Blake said, gesturing toward her chair. "Relax, finish your meal. We'll talk about it later."
Whitney opened her mouth, but nothing came out. She swallowed hard and sat back down. I knew she blamed me for everything that went wrong. If I hadn't ever come into her space, things would have been perfect for her. After dinner, Maddie and I went to our room. I could hear Blake talking to Dax and Whitney in the living room. It wasn't a private conversation, as far as I knew, but I went to the bedroom with Maddie because she said she needed to talk with me about something.
"Mom,"
Maddie said, as if she'd said my name 100 times.
"What?"
I said in a sharp whisper. I was trying to listen through the closed door to Blake's voice. I couldn't make out a single word.
"Just ask him later what he was talking about," Maddie huffed. "He'll tell you."
I shook my head. "What makes you think he'll tell me?"
"I just think he will." Maddie rolled her eyes. "But right now, you need to listen to me."
"Okay," I said, exhaling. I let their voices fade away as I focused on my daughter. "What do you want to talk to me about?"
"It's time, Mom,"
Maddie said, pushing back her shoulders. My nose wrinkled.
"Time for what?" "It's time for us to leave," Maddie said. "We have to get to Aunt Polly before something happens and we lose her."
"There is so much we need to do. Pack supplies, plan the route, and how are we going to make sure we have enough gas?" I asked. It probably sounded like I didn't want to find Polly, but that was far from the truth. I was afraid to lose Maddie while trying to find my sister. "There are a lot of bad people out there. If we run into the wrong people, we could end up in a bad situation," I said.
"I can take care of myself. I made it out of the apartment. I can survive anything," Maddie said.
There was a strength behind her words that impressed me.
"I know you helped me escape, but inside that place, there were only 2 people looking out for me."
Maddie swallowed hard.
"Me and Elias."
She quickly wiped away a tear. It was the first time Maddie had mentioned Elias since the day he'd lost his life. "He seemed to really care for you," I said. "I'm so sorry about what happened. It wasn't fair. The muscles in Maddie's face tightened. Her eyes darkened. It was like she was a robot and someone had powered her down.
"We can't delay this any longer, Mom. We need to get to Polly," Maddie said. "Maybe she's waiting for us. I'm sure she's scared and worried. What if she thinks we're dead?"
"I don't know," I said, shaking my head. Tears welled up in my eyes, but I couldn't let them fall.
"I thought she was dead. If we go out there unprepared, we could be dead."
"We have to try, Mom, right?" Maddie said, fighting back her own tears. "Polly would come for us. You know she would."
Maddie was probably right. I stepped up to her and wrapped my arms around her. I held her close.
"We'll go," I said. "We'll take your dad's truck."
"But when?"
Maddie asked, pulling back slightly to look into my eyes. "It'll take a few days to get ready. Charge my phone and make sure we have everything," I sighed.
"And we have to do it all without Blake suspecting anything."
Maddie gave me a half frown.
"I don't understand why you don't just tell him we're leaving."
"Because I'm afraid he'll want to come with us," I said.
"Why is that a bad thing? It sounds like the place that Polly is will be safe for all of us," Maddie said. "We should encourage them to come with us.
And if something goes wrong, it'll be my fault. They are safe here," I said, feeling the tension increasing in my neck. "I can't be the reason anything happens to them." Maddie shook her head.
"They're adults. If they want to go, they can make their own choice."
"I wish it were that simple," I said.
"Well, I think it is," Maddie said.
"It's just us going on the road trip, okay? Polly is our family. If she weren't out there,
we would—" We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.